Can I make it first of all very clear from the outset that we will be supporting the second reading of this bill, not because, as the member for Skipton and Ripon seem to suggest, that this bill was somehow or other a unionist game, an exclusively unionist demand. The provisions of this bill, and especially the provisions of this bill which seek to ensure that the Assembly cannot be torn down by those who want to see instability in Northern Ireland, and indeed for 3 years ensured that there was no Assembly and that there was instability. We wanted these changes to ensure that that could not happen, not for the benefit of the DUP, not for the benefit of the unionist community, but for the benefit of the whole of the community. So I just want to make that point very clear at the outset, Madam Deputy Speaker. This is not a unionist game. This is not a unionist bill. This is not a unionist demand. This is an attempt by the parties in Northern Ireland, led by ourselves in the negotiations, to ensure that we could not have 3 years when we had no government in Northern Ireland, and incidentally, when, because it was afraid to take on Sinn Féin, the government sat on its hands here in Westminster and refused to do anything to try and get a situation going where devolution was restored in Northern Ireland. So that's the first point I want to make. Second point I want to make is this. There's a certain irony that we have the Secretary of State standing here today saying that, and we heard his honey words, that this bill was all about the government's commitment to the constitutional integrity of the United Kingdom, that parties should not be making threats to bring down devolution. And yet, in the same breath, he describes how, once again, he intends, if it is necessary, to cast devolution aside, to take on the responsibilities of the devolved administration in Northern Ireland, to satisfy the threats of one party and one party alone, and that's Sinn Féin. Because, of course, the current impasse in Northern Ireland and the fears that we had were that Sinn Féin were threatening not to appoint a Deputy First Minister if they did not get the cultural aspects of the New Decade, New Approach delivered in a timetable which they demanded. And I've got to say, whilst my party has signed up to the culture aspects, there are many people, I suspect, including Sinn Féin voters in Northern Ireland, who really are questioning whether, at a time when we're coming out of COVID, with hospital waiting lists sitting at about 350,000, with schools with lots of children who missed out on their education and need catch up, with unemployment having doubled as a result of the COVID restrictions, that the main concern and the threat to devolution again was that if you do not do the cultural aspects of the new decade, new approach, and allocate resources to it, and allocate assembly time to it, and allocate political capital to it, then we will not allow devolution to be set up again. And pathetically, and I say this pathetically, Madam Deputy Speaker, those threats have been caved into again by the Secretary of State with the commitments which he made to Sinn Féin. If it is not done in the Assembly by the end of September, I will take on the devolution powers and do it in Westminster. Either he wants parties in Northern Ireland to work together, or he doesn't. Either he wants to try and take the poison out of the system which there is in Northern Ireland, or he doesn't. And I can tell this House one thing, that if this one-sided pandering to Sinn Féin, setting aside the devolved powers, continues, then all he is doing is allowing Sinn Féin to come back time and time and time again. Because this is the irony. This is a party which refuses to take its seats in this house. This is a party which wants to see Northern Ireland divorced from the rest of the United Kingdom. But when they get to a situation where they cannot get their own way, where's the first place to go scurrying to? A British Secretary of State. The British House of Commons. Please do these things for us, because we can't persuade people in Northern Ireland to do them. And I think that the Secretary of State should think very carefully about the way he undermines devolution. This bill is meant to be all about sustaining devolution, to try and make devolution stronger, to try and stop it being hijacked by any one party, to try and stop the disruption that we had in the past. And yet we see that at the same time as this bill is going through, we've got the Secretary of State once again giving the green light to a party which doesn't want to see stability in Northern Ireland, which doesn't really care whether there's stability in Northern Ireland, and gives priorities to its niche demands over the main concerns of people, whether they're unionist or nationalist in Northern Ireland, namely to get money spent and time devoted to dealing with the essential day-to-day issues. Let me, I've got to say, and I listened to the chairman of the select committee who endorsed this approach. I've got to say, Madam Deputy Chairman, the kind of condescending, patronising attitude that we get from the chairman of the Northern Ireland Affairs Select Committee doesn't go down very well in Northern Ireland. This kind of condescending attitude, if the natives can't get it together, then let's do it here. Like he was talking like some 19th century colonial ruler. Well, I've got to say, you know, that kind of attitude. But of course, there are difficult situations, and there are difficult decisions to be made in Northern Ireland. I served as a minister in the Northern Ireland Executive for 5 years. I served as finance minister in the Northern Ireland Executive. And I've got to say, there was none of the parties ever accused the DUP at that stage of being one-sided in the way in which it dealt with the finances across departments. My own party actually complained more about not getting money for certain things than some of the other parties did, because that's just the job. If you don't have enough money, you can't give everything they ever asked for. But there was never, no one ever accused of being biased. We worked our way through difficult issues. During that period, we worked our way through the most difficult issue of the devolution of policing and justice. And for any member of this House to suggest that the natives can't work their way through these things, so we have to take these things over occasionally, all it does is ensure that those who wish to be intransigent will continue to be intransigent, because they know they've got the safety valve of running to the Secretary of State's door, and he will then sort it all out for them rather than sorting out for themselves. So I know that it is not part of this bill, but the Secretary of State mentioned it today, and he mentioned his intention in this House today. And I give warning to him that if he wants to find a way of undermining devolution, if he wants to find a way of making it difficult for parties to work together, then let him continue down this road of giving in to people who, because they threaten, or maybe the government fears that Sinn Féin have more of a threat than any other party in the executive, and therefore they have to be pandered to, and it does not augur well for devolution. The terms of the bill itself, I think that the period of up to 24 weeks for reflection and for attempts to try and overcome the difficulties which there are, when sometimes you do have issues which parties don't see eye to eye on, which they can't agree on, and which are important to them, that 24-week period with ministers in place. Though I would point out, and I take the point which I think was made by the Shadow Secretary, what power should those ministers have? And that's a very fine balance. Do you have 24 weeks in which ministers have full power without accountability? Do you have 24 weeks in which ministers have no power other than to administer issues and therefore aren't able to deal with serious issues which come? And I mean, I don't have an easy answer to that, but I think that she did pose an important question. If there is going to be, and I think that there may be occasions when that elongated period is necessary, if you are going to have that elongated period, you've got to be very clear. What can ministers do during that time? If they're simply there as lame ducks, then there's no point in having them. And yet if they're there as being able to do everything that they would normally be able to do with assembly scrutiny, I think there'd be very grave concerns about that. And I hope that during the committee stage of the bill, some of those issues will be teased out. I don't know whether it's easy to codify it or put it into the terms of the bill, but certainly it's not an issue which can be ignored. The second point around the petition of concern and the changes in the petition of concern. And I note again what the member for Skipton Ripon said, that the changes were necessary to stop the abuses of the petition of concern and the abuses by the large parties. First of all, let me make something clear. The Belfast Agreement did not put any limitations on the petition of concern. It can be used for whatever purpose, and that was drafted. And incidentally, it was drafted not by Sinn Féin or the DUP. We weren't the largest parties when the Good Friday Agreement was negotiated. It was drafted in that form by the SDLP and the Ulster Unionist Party, who thought that they would be the ones who would be able to exercise the petition of concern. And, you know, I must say it's very significant that now that unionists are no longer have a majority in the Assembly, that those who clamoured for the petition of concern because they said it was necessary to protect minorities are now the ones who wish to see it watered down. But there weren't abuses of the petition of concern. Indeed, it wasn't even all that often used. And when it was used, in fact, all parties used it. And I'll tell you, the time when it was used and abused most was by the SDLP on when it came to welfare reform. So, you know, I'm sure we'll get some lectures about the petition of concern when the SDLP speakers get up to speak in this. But all I can say is that the changes in the petition of concern, incidentally, there's no one party now would have 30 places to exclusively put forward a petition of concern. But secondly, the petition of concern was there as one of the safety mechanisms in the agreement for where there were divisive issues and where one bloc tried to impose those issues on others, that they would be that there would be that safety mechanism there. Incidentally, and it's significant again, an example of the government's interference. There is nothing more divisive in Northern Ireland, Madam Deputy Speaker, than the Northern Ireland Protocol. And yet, the safety measures which were in place in the Belfast Agreement for issues like the Protocol have been totally removed. They were totally removed when the Protocol and the Withdrawal Agreement was brought here to the House of Commons. And as a result, we now have the Protocol being able to be pushed through without any real say by the people who are most affected by it, though, as members have already pointed out here today, it's beginning to affect some of their constituents because they can't even trade in Northern Ireland. But, you know, again, another example of where, in order to obtain certain objectives, the government has picked, cherry-picked parts of the safeguards which were built into the constitutional structure of Northern Ireland. And, this is what angers, I think, many people in Northern Ireland. It seems to be done for those issues which most affect the unionist community, and I'm sure some of my colleagues will have something to say on some of the other issues. Madam Deputy Speaker, we will be supporting this bill tonight, but I think that the points which I've made about the government wanting sustained devolution, if they wish to sustain devolution and if they wish to see devolution prosper, then it requires more than just this bill. It requires them to show the same respect to devolution in Northern Ireland as he would show in Scotland and Wales. And I guarantee no Secretary of State, either for Scotland or Wales, would dare interfere in the devolved settlements in those two countries in the way in which this Secretary of State and this government has done in devolution in Northern Ireland.